What we are going to learn is an overview using diagram to show steps in gene cloning. So students need to be able to memorize the steps in gene cloning. So stepnya ada lima. Satu, dua, tiga, empat, lima. And then you should be able to describe the steps in gene cloning. Okay, describe the steps. What does it mean with isolation of gene? What does it mean with cleave? What do we use when we cleave or cut the DNA? What do we do during insertion? And who is being transformed? And what is being amplified? And then, what does it mean with screening? Dekat screening ni nanti kita akan apply konsep genetic marker, gene marker. Marker gene tadi, sebelum yang kita belajar. Okay, yang ni maknanya you kena revise balik 8.1, iaitu ciri-ciri vector, ciri-ciri host dan ciri-ciri vector host. Vector dengan host lah yang banyak kita tengok ciri-ciri dia. Kenapa ia sesuai jadi vector, kenapa ia sesuai jadi host. What is gene cloning? Gene cloning is the production of exact copies of a particular gene or DNA sequence using genetic engineering techniques. So we actually, we want to produce the copy of a particular gene. So the example that I gave before is the production of insulin. So we are going to copy the gene that encodes for insulin production. Insulin is a protein, remember? So we are going to copy the particular gene, the gene of insulin, using genetic engineering. So the purpose is to produce organisms with a new genotype. So the organism with the new genotype would be the bacteria. The bacteria that contain the gene of interest, the gene for producing insulin. So the example of gene cloning, the best example is human insulin produced by bacteria containing the clone gene insulin gene. Siapa tak faham setakat ni? So the gene of interest is the insulin gene. The host is the bacteria. The vector would be the plasmid. Okay, faham eh yang tu? Methods in gene cloning, kalau kita tengok gambar rajah ni sangat kecil lah. Awak boleh tengok pada nota ataupun nanti kita akan tengok gambar yang lebih jelas. Ada lima step tadi. Kalau ikut tadi sebelum ni, kita ada lima step. Satu, dua, tiga, empat, lima. Okay. Kita akan ulang-ulang ni lah. Isolation. A plasmid isolated from a bacterial cell and insert DNA from another source. So isolation is actually kita isolate the plasmid of a bacteria and then we isolate the foreign DNA, the gene of interest. Lalu kita isolate plasmid di sini. Kemudian kita akan isolate gene of interest kita. Ini dapat daripada DNA, DNA manusia contohnya. Okay, the second step would be plasmid become a new recombinant DNA molecule because the plasmid receive the gene of interest. So this is the recombinant plasmid or recombinant DNA. And then the recombinant plasmid, kena tambah the recombinant plasmid will return to a bacterial cell to form a clone of cells. So bacteria tu unicellular. Jadi bila dia dah terima recombinant plasmid, dia akan jadi clone of cells. And foreign DNA, it carries, foreign DNA carries the foreign DNA that the bacterial cell carry. The foreign DNA that the bacterial cell carry will be cloned. And then at the same time, it will make many copies. Macam mana dia boleh make many copies? Sebab kita belajar kan, setiap DNA tu mesti ada tempoh untuk dia replicate. Ada satu dalam setiap kita hidup, mesti ada replication of DNA. Jadi before the binary fission occur, so the DNA of the bacteria will be replicated. So bila dia dah replicated, itulah production of many copies. And then the production of multiple copies of a single gene will be known as gene cloning. So ini yang actually nak yang dikatakan gene cloning. So the steps are isolation, cut, insertion, transformation and amplification. Nanti kita akan, saya akan terangkanlah transformation dia akan sekali dengan amplification. Kenapa? And then the last step is screening. Screening is to identify which bacteria or which host, which bacteria carry the recombinant plasmid ataupun carry the gene of interest. Jadi kaedah screening yang kita akan guna nama dia blue white screening. Blue white screening eh. Nanti awak akan fahamlah kenapa nama dia blue white screening. Ikut gambar rajah ni. Okay, this one is the isolation. Isolation and isolation. And then insertion when the insertion is when the gene of interest inserted into the plasmid, the vector. And then the third step is plasmid put into bacterial cell. Kalau tengok tadi dia punya step yang ketiga adalah insertion. Okay, dia masuk ni kan insertion. Tapi dalam gambar rajah tu dia kata sebenarnya gambar rajah tu adalah proses transformation. Bermaknanya isolation kat sini, kemudian cut ni, tu dah second step. Okay, dia isolate. Second step dia sebenarnya dah cut. And then insert, ni dah third step. This one should be the fourth step. Empat eh. So empat ni adalah transformation and then amplification. Okay, last one, screening. Okay, last one is screening. Jadi kita kena sepadankan gambar ni dengan step yang ni. Kita akan ingat step yang ni. The keywords here. Ada soalan? First is isolation. During isolation, plasmid is isolated. Plasmid is isolated from E. coli and used as a cloning vector. Ingat lagi tak ada berapa jenis plasmid yang saya dah terangkan hari tu? Okay. Cuba ingat balik. Kalau tak ingat saya boleh sebutkan. Ada cosmid, ada PIEC kan? Ada plasmid, cosmid, ada PIEC. Okay. Plasmid yang paling banyak kita guna. So plasmid is isolated from E. coli. And then what's more important? Plasmid carries two important gene. Ingat tak ciri-ciri sesuatu vector yang bagus? Because it has marker gene. Okay, penanda. Gene yang boleh menjadi penanda bahawa gene of interest itu dah masuk ke tidak dan kemudian boleh menjadi penanda sama ada plasmid ini, sesuatu bakteria tu ada recombinant plasmid ataupun tidak. Okay, then the restriction site. The plasmid contain restriction site. So the restriction site is inside the Lac-Zac gene. Ingat balik Lac-Zac gene encode for beta-galactosidase. Jadi nanti kita akan gunakan ciri ni untuk identify bahawa Lac-Zac gene ni sudah terubah suai ke belum. Sebab apa? Sebab Lac-Zac gene nanti tempat di mana kita punya DNA, gene of interest kita akan diselitkan di antara Lac-Zac gene. Jadi Lac-Zac gene dia akan terubah suai lah, bermutasi. So bila dia berubah, maka dia tak boleh menghasilkan beta-galactosidase. Sebab tu kita boleh screen. Nanti kita akan tengok kenapa eh. Isolation of foreign DNA. So isolation involve isolation of plasmid and also foreign DNA, DNA gene of interest kita yang kita suka, yang kita nak eh. Plasmid is isolated and then the chromosome, bacteria chromosome, sorry. Kita tak ambil bacteria kromosom tapi kita ambil gene of interest. So this is the DNA from human that contain the sequence the sequence of DNA that encodes for insulin production. Okay, ini gene of interest. Jadi kita tak ambil semua, kita ambil sebahagian saja. Okay, then proses memotong. Cut process. Cut process processing. When foreign DNA is cut by restriction enzyme at the restriction site. So this cutting will form many thousand DNA fragments with sticky ends. Kita sebab dia dah specific sticky ends sebab apa? Sebab memang untuk insulin production memang akan menggunakan EcoR1. EcoR1 akan produce sticky ends. One of these fragments carry the gene of interest. Jadi kenapa? Sebab dalam DNA itu dia ada banyak restriction site. Jadi apa ni, enzyme, kita punya restriction enzyme, dia akan mana-mana dijumpai CoR1 contohnya, dia akan kenal pasti GAA-TTC. So there will be so many GAA-TTC sequence on our DNA. So it will cut so many and produce so many fragments because there are so many apa kita panggil tu, restriction site. Jadi setiap restriction site dia akan menghasilkan fragment DNA yang berbeza size. And at the same time, plasmid is cut open at restriction site with the same restriction enzyme. Jadi restriction enzyme bagi EcoR1, BAMH1, dia punya restriction site memang ada dalam gene, LEXAC gene. Okay? Sebab tu kita tahu, ini sebenarnya memang pengetahuan yang dah dikaji, hasil daripada research di lab. Jadi memang mereka dah memang spesifik bahawa EcoR1 restriction site di GAA-TTC memang berada dalam jujukan LEXAC gene. So why do we use the same restriction enzyme? Same restriction enzyme meaning if we cut the foreign DNA, the gene of interest using EcoR1, then we should use EcoR1 to cut the plasmid. Nah, kita tak boleh satu EcoR1, satu BAMH1. Maka nanti akan terhasil satu GKN. Kita takut kalau semawan dia akan menghasilkan blunt end. Okay. Macam BAMH1, walaupun dia sama juga menghasilkan sticky end, tetapi jujukan dia berbeza. Dia bukan GAA-TTC. GAA-TCC. Jadi nanti dah tak complementary. Right? Our purpose to use the same restriction enzyme is to form compatible ends on both the foreign DNA fragments and the plasmid. So that nanti bila kita sambungkan, dia boleh form hydrogen bond complementary. The cleaving, cutting. Right. Bacterial plasmid is cut at the restriction site. Jadi dia terbuka ni macam, okay, human DNA containing gene of interest, dia akan hasil banyak fragment ni. Akan hasil banyak fragment. Tapi dalam banyak-banyak ni akan ada satu yang memang gene of interest kita. Jadi ni akan kita assume sebab dia akan campur ni semua ni. Ada fragment gene of interest, ada fragment bukan gene of interest. Maknanya dan plasmid ni bukan satu saja. Sebab bila kita isolate plasmid, kita akan dapat plasmid yang banyak. So plasmid ni akan ada dalam satu Whirling tube ataupun test tube. Manakala fragments gene of interest akan berada dalam satu lagi test tube. So bila test tube ini, okay, ini dalam satu test tube ini containing gene of interest. Another test tube here containing plasmid, ini plasmid. So there are so many plasmid, the plasmid are cut open. Then kita masukkan fragment kat sini, right, fragment. And then we mix this mixture together. Right, kita sekalikan plasmid dengan gene of interest ataupun fragments of DNA. Kita panggil fragments of DNA sebab ada fragments bukan gene of interest, ada yang gene of interest. So there are some plasmid that will receive the gene of interest and another plasmid might receive the fragments of DNA that is not the gene of interest. Jadi akan ada dua jenis. Dan satu lagi jenis, there would be an amount of DNA that did not receive any fragments of DNA. So it just will close up and become the original plasmid. So akan ada tiga jenis plasmid. Faham tak? Apa faham? Ha, nampak eh? Sebab tu gambar kat sini. Kat sini dia adalah non-recombinant plasmid. So this plasmid does not receive any fragments of DNA. While there are some DNA that receive DNA fragments, but it is not the gene of interest. Okay? So akan ada dua jenis. Yang terima fragments of DNA, dia akan ada dua jenis. Satu jenis pertama adalah jenis yang recombinant plasmid yang terima gene of interest. Dan ada yang recombinant plasmid tak terima gene of interest. Okay. Fakta tu awak kena ingat. Yang ke yang fakta yang mula tadi bahawa gene of interest sepatutnya duduk di leg Z gene. Okey, dia akan terbuka dan masuk di leg Z gene. Okey. Okay, insertion. Plasmid and DNA fragments are mixed to allow the formation of hydrogen bond. Inilah sepatutnya insertion when the plasmid receive the gene of interest. Okay, DNA ligase dia adalah enzyme yang akan form phosphodiester bond between the gene of interest and the restriction site of the plasmid. Okay, ni yang recombinant plasmid lah. Jadi kalau yang terima gene of interest kita panggil dia recombinant plasmid. Yang terima fragments of DNA, it might be the recombinant plasmid, tetapi ciri dia mungkin berbeza. Okay, ciri dia mungkin berbeza. Yang tak terima any fragments, it is not the recombinant plasmid. There are many other combinations that will be formed. The recombinant plasmid with gene of interest. The second one is recombinant plasmid with other foreign DNA fragment. And the third one is plasmid without any foreign DNA. So the plasmid without any foreign DNA fragments will be called as plasmid saja. Yang mana yang terima foreign DNA, either it is interest, gene of interest or not, it is called recombinant plasmid. Yes. Let's look at insertion. Ni insertion ni gambar tadi daripada diagram yang full tadi. Okay, insertion. Kita masukkan tadi kan. Masukkan the gene of interest. Jadi sebenarnya yang masukkan ni, dia berlaku secara bukannya kita masukkan one by one macam kita lekatkan kertas dekat gam. No, we cannot do that. Yang kita buat macam saya cakap tadi, kita akan masuk campurkan dia dalam satu tabung uji. Jadi kita akan induce proses tu dengan suhu ke, dengan bahan yang membolehkan bahawa gene of interest tu kadar kemasukan gene of interest ke dalam plasmid tinggi. Okay, so transformation. Transformation occurs when the recombinant plasmid and the non-recombinant plasmid is reintroduced into the host cell ataupun transferred into the host cell. Jadi katakanlah ini adalah recombinant plasmid recombinant plasmid. Nak masukkan dalam bakteria balik. So masukkan. Jadi ini yang dikatakan sebagai transformation. Proses memasukkan recombinant plasmid ni ke dalam DNA, ke dalam bakteria sel. Itulah proses transformation. Okay, using cold calcium chloride followed by heating. Kenapa? Sebab kita tak boleh disimpli, kita bukannya ambil plasmid ni dan cucuk masuk dalam macam kita cucuk vaksin tu. Bukannya kita inject masuk dalam bakteria kan. Tetapi kita sama tadi, kita akan masukkan dalam tabung uji ataupun biring petri ke, kita akan biarkan dia terima. Biar dia terima. Maknanya plasmid ini sepatutnya meresap atau bergerak masuk ke dalam bakteria tersebut. Jadi nak meningkatkan keupayaan bakteria tu menerima recombinant plasmid, kita gunakan cold calcium chloride dengan suhu yang tinggi. So this will increase the bacteria membrane permeability to plasmid. Dia akan jadi lebih telap. Okay, bukan senang nak terima Bukan senang nak terima kalau dibiarkan macam tu saja. Yeah, dalam bekas sama dimasukkan plasmid tadi, kita campurkan dengan bakteria. So kita rawat dengan cold calcium chloride dan kita panaskan. So after transformation, maknanya kalau berlaku transformation, if the transformation occurs is when the bacteria receive ataupun allow the recombinant plasmid into the cell. Nampak tak dalam gambar rajah ni? Ada sel bakteria yang ada plasmid, ada yang tak ada plasmid. So there will be some of the bacteria that will not transform. Dia tak terima lah. Dia tak terima recombinant plasmid ataupun plasmid and plasmid. So when it does not receive the recombinant plasmid, then it is not transformed. Okay? Sebab tu kita tak boleh ambil satu sel dan kemudian masukkan. Tak boleh. Benda tu adalah suka. Awak bayangkan bakteria ni sangat kecil. Plasmid ni mesti lagi kecil. Macam mana kita nak ambil satu-satu masukkan dalam bakteria? So it is a very messy process. So how do we do? Kita induce supaya kebarangkalian ia berlaku lebih tinggi. Right. Jadi kita akan, sebab tu kita kena ada screening. Sebab in the end, kita akan ada possibility. There will be a possibility that the there are some bacteria that did not receive the recombinant DNA. Okay. Sebab tu kita kena screening. Kita kena identify yang mana transform, yang mana tak transform. So, from observation, there are a few groups of bacteria. Some bacteria contain gene of interest. Some bacteria contain other foreign DNA fragment, not the gene of interest. And some bacteria contain non-recombinant plasmid. But the plasmid is there, but it is not a recombinant plasmid. And some bacteria will not receive any plasmid at all. Dah ada empat dah. Tadi kita dah, bila kita cerita tentang plasmid recombinant tadi, ada tiga jenis saja, iaitu satu, dua, tiga. Jadi bila kita dah combine dia dengan sel, dengan bacteria sel, bakteria ini ada yang ciri yang keempat, iaitu did not receive any plasmid. So when it does not receive any plasmid, ada beberapa ciri dia yang ketara tidak akan dia perolehi. So the four groups of these bacteria can be identified. Kita boleh rule out a few groups through screening step. Okay, through screening step. Ada soalan nak tanya?
Madam.
Yes.
Nak tanya boleh?
Boleh. Kenapa tak boleh pula?
Madam, nak tanya kalau pasal yang diverse pool of bacteria are produced tu, kalau some bacteria do not receive any plasmid, maksudnya tak ada plasmid lah. Maksudnya tak ada memang apa-apa langsung.
Ya, dia tak ada terima apa-apa apa-apa plasmid langsung.
Benda ni during transformation ke, madam?
Selepas transformation. Maksudnya, masa transformation tu sepatutnya kita expectation kita semua bakteria tu terima plasmid. Tapi sebenarnya in the end ada yang tak terima. So kita kena consider possibility itu.
Okay. Thank you, madam.
Alright. Okay. Contoh macam kita buat hypothesis. Apabila bakteria dicampurkan dengan recombinant plasmid ataupun dicampurkan dengan plasmid, bakteria akan menerima, semua bakteria akan menerima plasmid. Tapi hasil uji kaji menyatakan bahawa terdapat bakteria yang tidak menerima plasmid. So apa bukti yang bakteria ni tidak menerima plasmid? Itu yang kita akan dapat daripada screening. Uji kaji dia adalah screening. Okay. Ada lima tadi kan? Lima. Bacteria containing non-recombinant plasmid. Some bacteria contain recombinant plasmid. Sekejap. Okay. These are the bacteria that contain recombinant plasmid. But there are some bacteria that did not receive any plasmid. So what is amplification? Is the process of multiplication. So kita boleh similarkan atau samakan proses amplification dengan multiplication. Maksudnya kita nak gandakan. Amplify ni maksud kita tambah nak bilangan dia. Itu sebab amplify ni meningkatkan kan? Meningkatkan. Jadi apa yang kita tingkatkan, apa yang kita tambah, iaitu bilangan dia. So multiply the copies of recombinant plasmid when the bacteria grow to form colony. Bilangan bakteria ni memang kalau kita letak kat dalam petri dish dengan agar-agar yang tertentu, dia akan hidup bertambah biak. Dan bertambah biak tu dalam bentuk, biasanya dalam bentuk koloni. Dia akan dalam bentuk spot koloni, bulat. Plate out the transformed bacteria on solid nutrients medium which contain first ampicillin. Maknanya dalam agar-agar ni, nutrien agar, dipanggil nutrien agar. Bahasa Melayunya agar nutrien lah. So this nutrien agar contain ampicillin. Ampicillin is an antibiotic. And then ada sugar X-gel. Ada gula, ada sejenis gula yang dipanggil X-gel sugar. Sugar X-gel. Jadi kenapa letak ampicillin ni? Kenapa ada letak sugar X gel? Sebab tadi kita tengok ada dua genetic marker tadi. Nampak ingat tak? Slide yang awal-awal tadi, ciri-ciri. Ni, the bekas plasmid carries two important genes, ampicillin resistant gene and then Lac-Zac gene. Sebab tu bila kita nak buat screening, kita akan tengok dua ciri ini. Apa yang berubah? The ampicillin is the ampicillin resistant gene tadi, berkaitan dengan ampicillin resistant gene. While sugar X gel is related to the Lac-Zac gene. Our observation from amplification. From the observation, there will be two types of colony of the bacteria. Ada dua jenis. Satu koloni berwarna putih, satu lagi berwarna biru. Okay, yang pertama awak kena ingat nama screening tadi, blue-white screening. So blue-white tu datang daripada warna koloni. So which colony would we want? The transformed bacteria containing recombinant plasmid is the white one. The transformed bacteria that contain non-recombinant plasmid is the blue one. So which one do you think that we want? The white or the blue?
White.
Kita nak yang white. Dekan recombinant plasmid kan? Okay, sekarang ni bacteria do not receive any plasmid. No colonies are formed. Dia tak hidup lah maksudnya. Okay, dia mati. Maknanya yang hanya yang ada dua plasmid, hanya ada dua jenis ni saja yang akan survive dalam agar ni. Agar ni sebab tadi apa? Ada ampicillin. Jadi bakteria yang tak ada plasmid sebab tadi plasmid ada gene that resist the ampicillin. So kalau bakteria itu tak ada plasmid, any plasmid, sama ada recombinant plasmid or non-recombinant plasmid, they will die because of the ampicillin present. So antara dua ni sama ada recombinant atau non-recombinant. Jadi kita nak tentukan yang mana satu recombinant, mana satu non-recombinant. Kita akan tengok pada warna. Why blue and white bacteria are able to form colonies but not for other group of bacteria? Because bacteria that cannot grow in the agar are killed by the ampicillin. Kenapa dia mati sebab ampicillin? Sebab dia tak ada gene that resist the ampicillin. Dan gene ini sepatutnya ada dalam plasmid. So makna bakteria yang mati ni sebenarnya dia tak ada plasmid. Jadi kita jenis kumpulan ni tadi, yang ini sudah kita eliminate menggunakan ampicillin. Okay. Jadi yang kedua, ciri yang kedua adalah either the bacteria contain the non-recombinant plasmid, makna plasmid yang kosong, atau recombinant plasmid, plasmid yang ada gene of interest. Okay. So transformed bacteria contain plasmid with ampicillin, plasmid that have ampicillin resistant gene. So the bacteria are resistant to ampicillin. So either blue or white, itu adalah bakteria yang terima plasmid. Okay, sebab tu dia dipanggil transformed bacteria. But now the difference between the blue and the white colony. A blue-white colony is to identify transformed bacteria colony that contain recombinant plasmid. So kita nak rule out, kita nak keluar, kita nak ketepikan bakteria yang mengandungi plasmid biasa, bukan plasmid recombinant. Okay, based on Lac-Zac selection. Sebab apa Lac-Zac ni sepatutnya menghasilkan beta-galactosidase. So ingat lagi tak fungsi beta-galactosidase? Encodes for? Beta-galactosidase fungsi dia masa kita bincangkan lactose operon kan? Ingat lagi tak? So beta-galactosidase ni dia akan hydrolyze lactose. Jadi beta-galactosidase supposed to hydrolyze the lactose and then produce monosaccharide. Jadi kalau dalam kes ini X gel ni dia mengandungi bahan yang akan digunakan untuk oleh beta galactosidase. Jadi kalau ada beta galactosidase, X gel ni akan di metabolizekan. Sebab tu beta bila metabolize dia akan berubahlah, berlaku suatu perubahan. Okay. Non-functional lexac gene, maksudnya lexac gene ni disrupted sebab bakteria yang mengandungi recombinant plasmid dekat dia punya restriction site tu, lexac gene dia dah dipotong kan, dan kita masukkan gene of interest. Masuk gene of interest. Jadi lexac gene disrupted. So bila lexac gene disrupted, beta galactosidase is not produced. Jadi bila tak ada beta galactosidase, the bacteria will be unable to hydrolyze X-gel sugar. Okay, unable to hydrolyze X-gel sugar. So white colonies are produced. The colony dia jadi warna putih. Unable. Manakala bacteria that contain non-recombinant plasmid will produce colony with blue color. Kenapa? Kenapa dia bertukar jadi biru? Sebab asalnya agar ni memang warna putih lah. Jadi dia jadi warna biru. Agar ni sebenarnya warna dia macam warna jernih sikit. Jadi yang tadi memang putih macam putih susu. Tapi bagi blue colony, they can produce beta galactosidase sebab the lexac gene is still intact. Tak ada perubahan. So there is no gene that will be inserted into the lexac gene. Tak ada. Jadi lexac tu tak berubah. So when lexac gene is intact, beta galactosidase is produced. So with the presence of beta galactosidase, this bacteria will be able to hydrolyze the X-gel sugar, the agar tu lah kan, and then form blue colored products. Ada siapa nak tanya soalan? That's why blue colonies are formed. Ni contoh ni gambar real. Ni warna biru. So yang ini yang kita tak nak. Kita nak yang ada recombinant DNA. Okay, ada soalan nak tanya. Tapi kena ingatlah, recombinant DNA ni, jadi antara biru dan putih, kita akan continue kita punya research dengan yang warna putih. Sebab warna putih ni, dia ada DNA, ada recombinant plasmid. Tetapi kita kena buat saringan lagi sebab recombinant plasmid ni kemungkinan dia mengandungi our gene of interest, iaitu gene yang menghasilkan insulin. Dan kemudian ada juga yang mengandungi fragments of DNA. Fragments DNA yang bukan menghasilkan insulin. Jadi kita kena, yang itu kita kena identify. Jadi yang tu awak tak belajar dah. Ya, setakat screening, blue white screening. Okay. Ada soalan nak tanya? Tak ada soalan nak tanya ?
Tak ada, madam.
Okay, good.
Madam.
Ya.
Why is the recombinant bacteria containing recombinant plasmid has non-functional lexac gene?
Because the gene of interest or the fragments of gene, the foreign DNA, will be inserted in the lexac gene sequence. Sebab restriction site. Ingat tak tadi?
Can you repeat your sentence again just now? What is inserted lah?
The foreign DNA.
Okay.
So, you know why? Sebab you kena ingat bahawa apa tadi saya kata tadi? Restriction site. Ingat dia. Restriction site is in the lexac gene punya sequence. Dan okay, mana ni?
I understand already. Thank you.
Okay. Alright. So, Bella. Yang tu selesai. Boleh faham? Kenapa kenapa recombinant plasmid dah tak mampu menghasilkan beta galactosidase? Because the presence of the gene of interest ataupun foreign DNA ada pada lexac gene punya sequence in between. Jadi akan berubah, lexac gene akan berubah. Nanti bila kalau sepatutnya transcription dengan trans, sepatutnya transcription dia akan transcribe exact gene. Betul tak? Dia akan transcribe exact gene dan hasilkan hasilkan mRNA yang akan encode for exact gene. Tetapi masalahnya bila dah berlaku kemasukan insertion of foreign DNA into the exact gene sequence, jadi dah berubah, jadi masa transkripsi dia akan transcription tu dia akan menghasilkan mRNA yang mengekodkan gene yang baru, bukan lagi exact gene. Okay, faham? Alright. Okay, saya akan sambung dengan 8.3 pula eh. Like 8.3 is about application of recombinant DNA technology. Application. Kita akan cerita tentang apa yang dah ada dekat dalam dunia ni yang menggunakan kaedah recombinant DNA technology. So the application, briefly explain applications of recombinant DNA technology in mass production of insulin using cDNA. Nanti saya akan terangkan apa, kenapa maksud dia cDNA, kenapa bukan DNA saja. Why there is a C here. And the next one is describe the steps in production of insulin using cDNA. Okay, pertama kita nak explain application ataupun apa ni, dia punya step dia, masa dia apa, kenapa kita gunakan recombinant DNA technology ni untuk menghasilkan insulin secara besar-besaran. Okay, kita akan pergi situ dulu eh. Ni contoh ni, the glowfish is a genetically modified fluorescent zebrafish, became first genetically modified animal to become so popular and open to the public as a pet. Glowfish eh. Saya pun tak biasa bela ni. These cats carry genes that have been altered genetically to enable them to glow in the dark. Ada eh? Ada juga. Tapi saya tak pernah jumpa lagi. Ni yang paling mudah kita jumpalah. Ordinary tomato easily rotten, becomes rotten. Selepas 20 hari dia dah ni. Tapi kalau gene silence maksudnya gene ia telah diubah suai untuk gene yang berkaitan dengan ripening ni. Okay, dia akan maintain firm when fully ripe. Tomatoes were the first genetically modified foods to come on the market. So are we eating a GMO, genetically modified organism? Light producing plant, starlight avatar. Right, ni awak boleh baca lagi lah macam-macam eh. Explanation, kita akan belajar tentang mass production of insulin using cDNA. Jadi secara introduction, kenapa kita perlu hasilkan insulin? I've told you before, because we patients with diabetic numbers are increasing. Sorry, the number of patients with diabetic are increasing. By year, makin meningkat, makin bertambah. But so we need a larger amount of insulin each year. Okay. So nak treat diabetic patient, kita perlu bekalan insulin. Nak dapatkan insulin, kita tak boleh ambil daripada manusia. Dan kalau ikut daripada zaman dulu, dia dah mula extract daripada haiwan. Sebab dia consider, scientist consider, ia less, orang kata, kalau haiwan macam tak, yelah kalau ambil daripada manusia seksa. Kalau haiwan, walaupun terseksa tapi bukan manusia, mungkinlah pandangan dia kan. Tapi makin lama, benda tu semakin susah juga. Sebab apa? Sebab allergic reaction. Okay, sebab allergic reaction. Because insulin from animal source are different chemically and can cause allergic reaction. Sebab tu kita kalau boleh kita nak as close to human as possible. Jadi kalau sebelum ni ambil daripada lembu, ambil daripada babi. Dan for Muslim, kalau boleh kita nak elakkan daripada bahan daripada babi. Okay, tak, kalau boleh memang tak boleh lah. Kalau dah tak, kalau dah kritikal, dah darurat, memang baru kita akan terima. Tapi rupanya manusia sekarang dah dapat satu jalan penyelesaian, iaitu ambil daripada manusia without extraction blood taken from the blood. So human insulin are produced by E. coli. E. coli ni yang menghasilkan insulin human. Save the time and cost of the treatment. Sebab pertama, life cycle bakteria memang sangat singkat dan dia boleh membahagi cepat dengan cepat. Dia boleh membahagi dengan cepat. So bila dia membahagi, dia replicate freely, dia boleh replicate dengan tempoh masa yang singkat, dia boleh menghasilkan insulin dalam masa yang singkat. So we use recombinant DNA technology using the E. coli, and the name of this product is Humulin, human insulin, Humulin. What is the benefit of insulin produced by genetic engineering? Jadi bila ditanya soalan ini ialah maksudnya ialah apa faedahnya bila kita gunakan kaedah genetic engineering ni dengan menghasilkan insulin daripada manusia. Pertama, because the insulin produced is human insulin, so it is safe. Compatible, maksud compatible, dia tak ada allergic reaction. Tidak menghasilkan allergic reaction. The third one is halal ataupun syariah compliance production. And cheaper, lebih murah lah. Sebab nak perbanyakkan bakteria, hanya guna petri dish. Tak perlu ladang yang besar. But then, produce insulin in larger quantities. Ataupun bulk production. So ni kena ingat apa benefit production of insulin from genetic engineering. Proses dia sama tadi, isolation, cleave, insertion, transformation and amplification and then screening. Selepas screening ni baru kita boleh hasilkan insulin tu. Kita dah screen, kita dah tahu. So using cDNA, okay, cDNA, pertama plasmid is isolated from E. coli. Kita akan nampak nanti kat mana perbezaan dia. Isolation, kenapa guna cDNA? Sebab C ni is come from the word complementary DNA. Jadi saya akan terangkan kenapa dia complementary. Okay, then single strand insulin mRNA containing target codon is isolated. So this is where it is different from the previous gene cloning step tadi. Kalau tadi isolation of gene of interest, tapi sekarang dalam konsep dalam penghasilan insulin, insulin ni dia punya isolation adalah isolation of mRNA. Okay, tadi secara umum gene cloning kita kata isolate gene of interest. Tetapi to be specific dalam penghasilan insulin, apa yang kita isolate daripada manusia adalah mRNA-nya, bukannya DNA-nya. Siapa boleh bagi tahu kenapa kita ambil mRNA instead of DNA? Kenapa kita tak boleh ambil DNA daripada manusia? Okay, single strand insulin mRNA that contain target codon. Kenapa kita sebut codon? Kita sebut codon sebab dia pada mRNA. Isolated from target cell. Kalau contoh manusia yang menghasilkan hormon insulin adalah pancreas. Jadi kita akan target organ kita adalah pancreas. Cell dia adalah cell yang menghasilkan insulin. Tapi kita tak ambil DNA of interest. Kita ambil insulin mRNA. Target codon. Kita ambil insulin kita ambil mRNA bukannya DNA. Ni bila nak terangkan tentang mass production of insulin. So kena mention single strand insulin mRNA. Siapa nak cuba jawab kenapa kita ambil mRNA instead of DNA?
Madam, can I try?
Ha.
Is it because because DNA is complementary? The DNA bases is complementary to each other, so it's actually the same thing, and RNA is just one strand.
Okay.
So can replicate from there.
Okay, thank you for your response, Pauli. Yeah, good job. But it's not it is not kita kata tak tepat, not precise. Actually because of the introns and exon. Dalam DNA, dia ada non-coding sequence. Sebab ini adalah daripada manusia, eukaryot kan? So kalau dalam eukaryot, dia ada proses RNA splicing selepas transcription. Before it is being translated, we have to remove the introns and only translate the exon, the coding sequence. So kena ingat balik, transcription, dia ada RNA splicing, process that remove the introns and then join the exon. Jadi siapa jawab KRT1, soalan nombor 3, sepatutnya must be aware of this fact. So again, we cannot take the gene of interest from the DNA because the gene will contain non-coding sequence and coding sequence. We just want the coding sequence. Kalau kita ambil DNA tu, kita kena perform proses RNA splicing sebab nak hasilkan protein kan, human insulin. Jadi to be exact, to produce MS insulin, we will take the insulin mRNA. So bila dah jadi mRNA, there is no more introns. So the mRNA is actually all of the coding sequence that should be translated later. Jadi kita ambil mRNA, maknanya dah tak ada introns lah. Sebab tu kita ambil mRNA. This isolated insulin mRNA will be incubated with reserve transcriptase. Kita akan gabungkan dia, campurkan sekali dengan enzyme reverse transcriptase. Okay, kalau transcriptase adalah enzyme yang akan mengaruh, yang that will catalyze the transcription process. But bila ada perkataan reverse kat depan, maknanya transcription ni akan terbalik. Okay, cuba ingat balik. Transcription adalah proses yang membaca DNA. It will read the DNA and copy the DNA sequence into a sequence of mRNA. Kan? Betul tak? Jadi bila reverse transcriptase, dia akan buat yang terbaliknya. So it will read the mRNA and then it will produce DNA. Dia terbalik eh. The reverse transcription is when the enzyme read the mRNA and then produce a complementary DNA. Jadi transcription, reverse transcriptase, dia akan guna mRNA sebagai template. Kemudian dia akan baca dan kemudian dia hasilkan complementary DNA. Right.
Madam.
Ya.
Macam ni ke yang konsep vaksin sekarang tu, madam?
Ya, betul.
Oh, okay.
Dia buka macam ni. Dia tak adalah exactly. Sebabnya macam Pfizer digunakan mRNA. So mRNA tu, kalau mRNA tu masuk dalam, macam saya disuntik Pfizer kan, mRNA yang masuk, sebab kita tak ada reverse transcription punya enzyme, reverse transcriptase. Jadi mRNA yang masuk dalam badan kita tu, dia takkan di reverse transcriptase menjadi DNA virus tu. So selamatlah, sebab tu selamat. Okay, badan kita tak ada reverse transcriptase. Jadi mRNA yang masuk, dia akan identified as foreign substance. Kemudian kita punya white blood cell, dia akan baca dan kemudian dia akan identify as foreign substance sajalah. Okay. Kalau masuk DNA, nanti kita bimbang DNA itu akan menghostkan ataupun mengganda menjadi virus yang lain. Alright, sebab tu kita gunakan mRNA bagi virus tersebut. Sebab selamat, sebab kita tak ada reverse transcriptase badan kita. Okay, reverse transcriptase ni dalam makmalah lab. Bila dicampurkan insulin mRNA dan kita campurkan dengan reverse transcriptase, it will produce a complementary DNA. Sebab tu dipanggil cDNA. C comes from the word complementary. This cDNA will be used in cloning and expression of prokaryote. Right. The first step, dia akan hasilkan single strand saja. Kemudian kita akan masukkan DNA. DNA polymerase, baru dia akan dapatkan strand kedua untuk yang tadi ni. Complementary DNA tadi. Kenapa kita guna insulin gene obtained from mRNA rather than DNA? Ini dah menjawab tadi soalan saya tadi. Difficulty in finding one gene among all the genes in the nucleus. So kita dah identify mRNA tu because then mRNA does not contain intron. mRNA contain introns. And the mRNA has or is already specific for a targeted gene. Eh, dia dah specific. So mRNA is used as template to produce complementary DNA. The reverse transcriptase catalyzes the production of single cDNA. Single eh, single strand dulu. Contoh ni mRNA, kemudian kita akan gunakan single DNA strand. Selepas proses reverse transcription, the insulin, the mRNA will be degraded. Eh, degraded by enzyme ribonuclease. Jadi kita tinggal single strand cDNA saja. So kita kena jadikan dia double strand. Sebab tu kita akan campur pula dengan polymerase synthesize, polymerase, DNA polymerase, which will synthesize the second cDNA strand. Tapi dalam masa nak hasilkan ni, kita kena ingat ada kena ada primer. Jadi dah complicated macam macam nak proses replication baliklah. Jadi cuma dia punya step dia bertambah sikit reverse transcription sebab kita tak nak yang intron tu. Kenapa kita tak nak yang intron? Sebab awak kena faham, intron ni hanya ada dalam eukariot. Kita nanti nak masukkan DNA ni, cDNA ni kita nak masukkan dalam bakteria. Bakteria dia tak ada, tak ada RNA spliceosome. Dia tak ada proses RNA splicing. So dia tak ada enzyme spliceosome. Sebab DNA dia semuanya adalah exon. Jadi kalau kita letak DNA yang ada intron dan kemudian kita minta bakteria tu untuk encode and produce the protein, then dia akan hasilkan protein-protein yang tak bermakna sebab ada intron. Dia tak boleh splice. Sebab tu kita kena bagi dia cDNA, iaitu DNA yang dah modified yang tidak ada introns. Faham? The next step is production of double-stranded cDNA which contain no introns. Then the cDNA carries complete coding sequence. No introns, eh? And undergo ligation using DNA ligase. Ni adapter eh. Adapter ligation catalyzed by DNA ligase. Sebab restriction site, kalau dia macam ni saja, okay nampak ni, blunt end saja. Nanti macam mana nak masuk dalam restriction site yang ada, yang telah dipotong oleh EcoR1. Jadi bila ada ni, adapter ligation, nanti kita campurkan dengan restriction enzyme. Restriction enzyme akan potong dan produce sticky end. So barulah boleh masuk dalam plasmid tadi. Plasmid is cut open at restriction site. Jadi ada sticky end. Kalau ni tadi tak ada sticky end, maknanya kalau kita biarkan dia tanpa ada sticky end, tak ada, sebab tu kena adapter ligation. Barulah akan terhasil complementary sticky end yang complementary sticky end. So this plasmid will be mixed with the restriction enzyme and then it will be cut open. The cDNA also will be cut open using the same restriction enzyme. Nah, ni dah masuk kepada step cloning, gene cloning tadi yang awak belajar. Cuma bezanya kat sini, DNA yang terhasil sudah adalah jujukan cDNA. Sebab ni dah specific application eh. Jadi dia punya proses bertambah dari segi bagaimana menghasilkan cDNA tersebut. Sebab kita isolate mRNA instead of the DNA. The restriction site, the restriction enzyme cuts the phosphodiester bond of the both the plasmid and the cDNA. So yang ni specific linear sticky ends eh. Linear plasmid with sticky end compatible to double-stranded cDNA fragment is formed. And then the DNA cDNA will be inserted into the plasmid. And then DNA ligase catalyzes the joining of plasmid and the cDNA fragment. Recombinant plasmid is produced. Okay, kita akan treat dengan DNA ligase supaya dia membentuk ikatan fosfodiester ni antara ni tulang belakang dia. Some plasmid unable to join with double strand cDNA. Masih juga masalah yang sama. Ada setengah plasmid dia tak jumpa dia punya cDNA. So this plasmid is called non-recombinant plasmid lah, konsep sama macam tadi. Transformation occurs when recombinant plasmid and non-recombinant plasmid is reintroduced. Sama. Okay, gambar yang sama. Diverse bakteria pun sama. Yang ni kita akan screen. Undergo screening. Kita akan identify yang mana tak terima, mati. Yang mana terima, dia akan sama ada di recombinant ataupun di non-recombinant. Yang ni recombinant dia dah terima cDNA pada Lexac gene. Yang ini tak terima. So amplification sama macam tadi. Kita akan identify menggunakan blue-white screening. So the white colonies will be identified as bacteria that contain recombinant plasmid. Yang lain sama eh. Yang berbeza adalah apa tadi? Sama dengan gene cloning. Yang berbeza sikit application ialah apabila ada proses penghasilan cDNA. Kita kena ada extra step untuk hasilkan cDNA dulu. Kalau tadi gene cloning, kita terus kata kita isolate plasmid dan isolate gene of interest. Tapi sebab ni dah application, jadi kita kena specific bahawa human insulin, untuk hasilkan human insulin, kita kena extract mRNA instead of DNA. The bacteria containing recombinant plasmid will be placed in fermentation tank to multiply. Fermentation plank. The insulin gene will be expressed via transcription and translation in clones of transformed bacteria. And then human insulin will be extracted and purified from E. coli. Jadi dia ada air dah hasil. Mungkin dia hasilkan air yang berisi human insulin ni. Kita akan extract lah.
Okay, that's all for now. Thank you.